I do have some slides, but I'm going to depart from a little bit because I know that I can get, as much as I love history, I can get lost in it. I think the starting point to talk about humanitarian intervention is that we should begin by recognising that imperialism has no place in the world, in a contemporary world. There is no basis for large powers saying, we will overthrow this country, we will present red flags on which we will intervene, we will interpret international law according to our own needs. That has no place in the international system because since 1945, the United System has set up a system which has been referred to before tonight where, although it's imperfect and the Security Council in particular is undemocratic, basically the proposal of the Security Council of the United Nations was to prevent war. The primary objective was to prevent war. The problem with humanitarian intervention is it has become a norm in front of that idea of preventing war that, well, there's a reason for going in, some reason for going in, and there are dozens of books. I mean, I had a look this afternoon. There are dozens of books on humanitarian intervention from Britain and from the US, basically. It doesn't come from most of the world. It comes from Britain and the US, the powers, the big powers that are the agents of this type of intervention. So humanitarian intervention has been around for a long time. It's really a legal doctrine. It's a form of putting a good face on war by calling it a lesser evil. That's a way of paraphrasing it. And I suggest that for those of us outside those particular countries, if we're going to support any version of these sorts of interventions, we have to look pretty carefully at what our moral position is. I've got this slide here just to show that the double game of pretext for intervention has been around for a very long time, predicted by the Cuban national hero Jose Martí when he saw a sinister plan, a provocation to enter a war. This is a very long history, pretext for entering a war. It's nothing particularly new. And the main incident, blowing up of the ship with US, killing over 200 US sailors, was a pretext for the US to go into the so-called Spanish-American War and take all the remaining colonies off Spain. So the idea's been around for a while. The recent theorists of it tend to be more on the liberal side of politics, hence the State Department, interestingly enough, in the US, which 30 years ago would have been regarded as more less warlike than the Defence Department. The tables have turned more or less. The media, like the British Guardian, the British Independent, are much stronger on this than the conservative media, and similarly in the US, it's the Democrats that are more in favour of this idea of humanitarian intervention rather than what Bass calls the realists, like the George W. Bush. The George W. Bush goes in with a direct invasion, thinks up a humanitarian pretext later on. The idea of a responsibility to protect was a type of more limited version of that constructed at the UN a few years ago, but it doesn't change anything in international law, and I think Malcolm spelled it out fairly correctly, that there are very limited bases for a country intervening in another country. There's the self-defense idea, which arguably you can say Iraq could go across its borders to deal with a terrorist conflict just spilling into Iraq. And there's the collective security concept in the United Nations, which is when in the cooperative of states, one state violates the borders of another, as in the case of the invasion of Kuwait, for example. A very limited pretext. The norm, the idea was to keep the norm of non-intervention there. So the imperial position, number three here, really is, it's around, of course, but it's inconsistent with international law and the United Nations Charter, and also with the human rights institutions. 15 years after the UN was created, there was a declaration on decolonisation, which spelt out the right of the people to self-determination. It became the first principle of the International Bill of Rights, and it's something that reinforces the UN system from 1945. So there's only really two plausible options in terms of this idea of humanitarian intervention. The first is one that I take, basically, the anti-imperial position, which says we are against intervention on principle because the intervention by the big powers will always be the greater evil, because the history of genocides, despite what's been written about Kosovo and Rwanda recently, a lot of that history, in my view, very distorted, historically the genocides have always been committed by the great powers. The Polish Jew Raphael Lemkin, writing about this in the 1940s, said that, and he was talking about the Armenian genocide and earlier genocides, he wasn't even talking about the genocide against the Jewish people, said that genocide, and Lemkin invented the word genocide, so it came into our lexicon recently, he said that genocide was a recurring feature of history, and he talked about empires in the past that had done this. So empires and their acolytes have typically been the people involved in genocides. It violates the Bill of Rights, Article 1 of the Bill of Rights. If you don't know Article 1 of the International Bill of Rights, go and have a look up. That's the basis of the anti-imperial position. The other position, which is really under the broad heading of humanitarian intervention, which covers a range of different political philosophical views, really is saying, I will make myself an accomplice to war. I will support a war against another country as a lesser evil, on the basis that I'm going to avert a greater evil by doing it. That's why the responsibility to protect has built into it this idea of crimes against humanity, war crimes and genocide. That's the way that was set up to try and fit in with international law without changing international law. So in other words, if anyone in another country says, I support the idea of humanitarian intervention, let's not beat around the bush, it says, I am going to be an accomplice to war. It's going to involve at least the slaughter of at least tens of thousands of people, if not hundreds of thousands of people. We know that we can see that with the recent invasions. I remember the war in Vietnam, many of you won't remember that, but the invasions of Afghanistan, Iraq and Libya are very eloquent evidence to that. So what I'd say to people who are considering being an accomplice to war in the name of humanitarian intervention, that if you're going to go down that line of logic, and it's a very strong line of logic in the Western media for reasons of culture and reasons of Western culture generally not coming to terms with its colonial background, with its imperial background, you have to have regard to these three things. First of all, international law, which is much more narrow than is often discussed, and I think Malcolm made that point to a fair degree. The other thing is independent on the pretext is very important, but very difficult to gain in the short term. But it's important. I'm going to show you two examples of that in the Syrian case. And the third thing is to observe conflicts of interest. Now, why this has become very important is because some of the doctrines within the United States, there's a number of doctrines, one of them is called exceptionalism, whereby it influences our culture here, in Western culture generally, that they don't see a conflict between an actual participant in an armed conflict and someone who is pretending to judge that conflict. And of course that's what's going on with the red flag theories and doctrines and so on. I'm going to skip over the history a little bit here of the conflict, but here's two trigger points I want to draw to your attention. Two trigger points, terrible massacres during the Syrian conflict, which were both attempted to be used for triggers for foreign military or deeper foreign military intervention, because as all the other speakers have pointed out, there's been some form of intervention, foreign military intervention. I say it's all been illegal on the basis I outlined before. The Hua massacre was a massacre of over 100 village people in a little village outside of Homs in an area that was held by the so-called rebel forces back in early 2012. They had a boycott on the elections at the time. The people that were killed, it was recognised, were mostly pro-government people. But nevertheless, a second UN report blamed the Syrian government. I'm not going to go into the detail here, but I'm showing you graphically that the shaded areas were the reports, the major reports that accused the government. And that involved most Western media reports, the British and the French government. They changed their stories a few times, but basically they blamed the government. The second UN Human Rights Commission of Inquiry, the first special mission on Syria inquiry, the report was buried. It exists, it was passed the Security Council, but it has never been published because the head of that body was rather equivocal. He said he couldn't really, he was getting conflicting stories about it. And some partisan videos from the armed groups themselves. The other ones in white were all contrary to that, saying that people were pro-government people, they were killed by anti-government armed groups. I have read and listened to the evidence of 15 witnesses that blamed the armed groups. It was entirely buried in the UN process. So that was the first pretext for intervention, escalated intervention, really the only major attempt at the UN Security Council to get UN authorization of intervention. But as we all know, the Russians and the Chinese blocked it in the Security Council. That was the end of it in the Security Council, more or less. But this was the event that was used at that time, with rather sophisticated media techniques, it should be added. The other event was the chemical weapons incident that Malcolm referred to in East Ghouta. Now, this was even worse in many respects, because far from being ambiguous, there's very powerful evidence that it could not have been done by the Syrian government. And that evidence comes from the US. But there's a number of independent reports on it. There was an important Syrian report led by a Christian nun who said, what happened to all these people that were shown in the videos? Not all of them were dead. Some of them were dead, some of them were wounded, some of them were wounded, apparently affected by gas or drugged. What happened to them? 8 bodies were buried. We were told 1,400 people were killed. That area was controlled by the group in Douma, and that Reem mentioned. Only 8 bodies were buried. And so not much attention has been paid to that fact. There have been stories circulating that these were children that were held kidnapped by rebel groups in the northern part of Syria, and the images were transmitted. In any case, only 8 bodies have been publicly buried from that incident. There are the independent reports. The report by Lloyd and Postol was addressing what the US government said was it was a weapon that was only held by the Syrian government, and the telemetry reports showed that it had come from a government area. Lloyd and Postol were scientists who showed that it could not have come from a government area because the trajectory of the rockets was maximum 2 or 3 kilometres, and the closest Syrian army post was 9 kilometres away from that area. Then there was Seymour Hersh's reports on intelligence and so on. So there you have a second incident. We almost had a major escalation based on that, and it was a fraud, effectively. There is significant evidence linking anti-government armed groups to that chemical incident. So there's the problem in these pretexts. There are some other war crimes and false flags. Are there demonstrable crimes by the Syrian army? I say yes. I say there is clear evidence the Syrian army has executed prisoners on the field of combat. That's the one clear crime I think has been shown by the army. The other ones, though, we have a series of them in Daraya and Akra. Akra, by the way, only a few kilometres from Hula, in an opposition-held area. Alawi villagers that were kidnapped and then slaughtered as they were driven out by the Syrian army. A whole series of false flag pretexts to try and attract stronger military intervention. So the lessons from that, I suggest, are, and I've skipped over a lot of history, even though I think history is important, humanitarian intervention backed by proxy armies as well as direct intervention. So in other words, the intervention of army in these groups, of course, is a form of humanitarian intervention in its logic. The US has been a belligerent party. It can't be regarded as an independent arbiter. The responsibility to protect doctrine carries a great risk of aggravating serious crimes. This idea of normalising the idea of humanitarian intervention, as opposed to normalising the idea of opposing war, has had very great dangers, because what it's led to in the Syrian case, I suggest, if you look at the detail of these particular massacres, is that the proxy armies carry out with impunity the worst atrocities, or manipulate their own crimes and their own casualties. There's evidence of them dressing up their own casualties as civilians, to attract greater military support, and continually doing that. That's been the great danger. It's aggravated the violence, that doctrine of humanitarian intervention in this case. If anyone is still convinced with the idea in their own self-image that they're going to support war in another country and be an accomplice to large-scale killing, I suggest you need to take very great care on the issue of international law, look at independent evidence, and consider the conflicts of interest. Thank you.